Hey, welcome to the exam preparation session for exam 70-411. This is the Administering Windows Server 2012, and my name is Cynthia Wang. I'm from Microsoft Certified Trainer from JDA TSG, and I'm also an Exchange PFE. And with me today is Ed. Take it away. Yeah. Take away
oh,
where?
Me.
Yeah.
Me. Oh,
you.
Yes. Hi.
Mr.
Yes,
Ed.
Mr. Ed.
Yeah.
Wilbur. my name is Ed Lieberman, and I am also a Microsoft Certified Trainer, MCT. I currently work with a company called Train Signal, where I am the lead Windows Server instructor, which is wonderful, I guess, since we're here today to talk about Windows
Getting
Server 2012.
That's right. Getting ready for your exam. So we're here because at this point, we're assuming that you've done some studying and you want to get certified in Windows Server 2012, and we want to see what are some of the things we can help you with. Think of this particular session as a checklist. So you want to get certified. Let's take a look. You want to get certified, and you've already done some studying, and you're looking at, so how do I know I'm ready to take the plunge, take the exam, and move on? So we're going to look at, very briefly, the certification path, see what are our options, and then look at what are the exam goals. We're going to look at some of the gaps in our knowledge, perhaps, gaps in our knowledge and how to fill those knowledge gaps. And we're going to take a look at, very briefly,
the exam tips and tricks.
Ticks and tricks. Tips and tricks. The exam tips and tricks. So some of the things that make us feel better about taking the exam, as well as, you know, best use of time and be confident in taking our exams. So let's start with, first of all, the certification path. And Microsoft certification went through a slight change.
Slightly,
just a little bit. We've seen a certification called MCSA. This is what we're interested in, the Certified Solutions Associate. And there are several exams that we're going to have to take in order to achieve that particular certification. And once you're confident in that, you can, of course, move on to the next level, which is the solutions expert. I keep thinking engineer. You know, that's flipping out already.
Almost said it.
The old system engineer, but no. The solutions expert. And, of course, once you honed your skills and you want to take the ultimate steps into becoming the guru of everything.
Right?
I like to say the guru
Microsoft
of everything.
Microsoft Certified Guru. Yeah. MCG.
Has a much nicer ring to it.
Yeah, that's right. You become a master.
Master, that's right. Master of a particular product, a particular topic. So definitely that's something to look into as well. So for our purposes, we are going to look at the MCSA certification. And the exams need to be prepared for, and based on these exam topics, is exam 410, which we have a separate session for, 411, which we're what we're talking about right now, and 412. They kind of have an interesting progression to them. You're familiar with installation, then you're moving on to administration, which is what we're doing right now, and then finally moving on to the detailed advanced steps of these services. And all of these exams have some similarity. For example, it's roughly 50 questions that you have to be able to answer correctly within 2.5 hours.
I have to answer all 50 correctly?
You have to answer all right. That's right. 100%
wow.
Or forget it. No.
Okay.
Just kidding. The passing grade is 700. It's not each questions are not evenly weighted. So certain questions will weigh way more than others. And that's, you know, fair. Certain questions seems extremely long. Multiple choice questions takes a few screens until you finish the question. Others seems shorter. So they are weighted differently.
Yeah. Well, there's another big misconception, and that is that 700 represents 70%.
Yeah.
And that's the other thing that is not necessarily true. 700 is a score that allows you to gauge how well you did against it. And really, quite frankly, it helps somebody who maybe did not pass the exam to know how close they were. If you pass the exam, I don't care if you got a 700, a 710, an 800, or a 1,000.
Yeah.
It doesn't matter. If you pass, you pass.
Yeah.
But if you fall below that 700, a lot of people have commented that it helps them out. You know, if you got a 680, you know you're pretty close to there. You go back and study a little bit.
Yeah, that's right.
Whereas if you got a 280, you got a lot of work ahead of you.
Mm-hmm. And it's a good thing also to know is for those of you that have already taken one of the Microsoft certified certification exams, you probably noticed that on the sheet that comes out at the end of it, it shows you different topics that you've been tested on and what score you got for individual ones. So it gives you an idea which area you're strong at, which area you need more work on. And this is especially important if you're just barely missing that 700 mark. Well, so we're going to look at these topics.
Well, those specific, those bars that you were talking about, where it shows you how well you did in each area, is specifically what we're going to talk about as far as the six different
topics,
objective areas. That's exactly where we're going to be at here. That's also what you're going to see in the exam. You know, before we get into that, though, I did want to comment on one thing. When we look at those three exams, the 410, 411, and 412 that you need, as you were just saying, Cynthia, we have another session on the 410 and on the 412. And if you have watched the session on the 410, you're going to notice that there's a lot of similarity to what we're covering here now in the 411, because it's the same areas of server that we're working with. It's that the 410 was installing and configuring, whereas the 411, we're now learning how to administer.
Yeah, so the day-to-day tasks.
That's the differences. Yeah. And also the other thing I do want to mention is it is, by many people, a recommended practice that whereas maybe in the past you would study for one exam and then go take that one exam, because there's so much overlap and there's so much supporting information, it's really good to study for the MCSA as a whole, study for your 4, 10, 11, and 12 together. And obviously you take one test at a time, but
each
of the pieces of information
they
will
build
help
on top of
supplement
each other.
Information from another test.
Definitely. Speaking of taking all the exams all at once, if you do have a strong background in, let's say, Windows Server 2008, and you think you know everything, you've learned all the new stuff that you want to know.
Oh, I know everything. Come on.
Guru here. Yeah, guru here. And you want to make sure that you want to do the certification for Server 2012 in the fastest way possible. And this is what we're talking about, the upgrade exam, the 417. And I'm going to let Ed advertise something.
Oh, I get to make my plug here.
You get to make your plug.
Yes. Well, a little while back, I was here and put together a jump start with Rick Claus. And there's a link at the bottom of your screen right now. We're actually going to have this link again for you later on at the end of this session. But if you go to this link, you can watch that jump start, which was specifically designed towards the 417 upgrade exam. So, you know, whereas here we're trying to help you specifically with one of the individual exams, the 411. If beyond that, if you are certified, if you are an MCSA in Windows Server 2008 and you want to go ahead and do that upgrade exam, that's another resource that you can use to help you get ready.
Yep, definitely. Okay, so now let's zoom in onto 411. Let's take a look at those objectives.
Zoom right in.
There
we go.
Focus. So here are our objectives, and they are pretty much weighted equally. You might see certain numbers change, but you're looking at between 15 to 20% per each of those topics that's going to be on the exam. So pay attention to some of these topics. Even if you think that you know a particular topic really, really well, don't neglect your basics. This is something I keep repeating to people, is when they become overconfident of a specific topic, they forget to review. And the topics that you're not strong on, you really want to make sure that you have adequate practice time and looking at those. So let's go over some of these objectives. And these six objectives listed in the slide here, we have deploy, manage, maintain server. If you looked at the 410 sessions, as Ed mentioned earlier, this objectives almost look identical. The only difference is instead of saying installing, it now says configuring. It's now configure. So you have everything installed already. Now you're just supporting your server, supporting the services and the roles and the features that's installed on the servers. What are some of the things you need to look through? So let's get straight to the first topic. Instead of reading through it, let's get to the first topic. Deploy, manage, and maintain servers. There are several things to look at, and I'm going to let Ed jump into the first one.
I get to talk?
You get to talk, yes.
I don't like to talk much. Anyone who knows me knows I don't talk very much. No, not at all.
I've got to push you out of that shell.
I'm a quiet guy. No, when it comes to, and again, like Cynthia was just saying, in the 410, it was all about the actual installation of a server and the original configuration of the server, whereas here we're now talking about deploying, managing, and maintaining those servers. And there are really the three main topics where we could start with, like, Windows deployment services. Okay, so we're not just talking about just deploying one computer anymore. We're not talking about inserting some media and clicking next, 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 finish. Okay, now we're talking about mass deployment of our servers, and even beyond that, mass deployment even of our clients too, right?
Yes.
We have our clients and our servers using Windows deployment services. And then we also have the WSUS,
right,
which that talk about something that has had its different revisions over the years.
Good old patch management.
Yeah. I personally liked it when it was WUS.
WUS, yeah. I still say that just for the fun of it.
Just for the fun
WUS
of it.
Windows Update.
Yeah, so it really has to do with like patch management and making sure that you're keeping your servers up to date. And this is really important. I really want to stay focused on this one for just a moment. When it comes to Windows, I always forget what it actually stands for, the actual Windows Server Update Services role, I believe is the official name now. Again, it's had its many revisions. This is key because updates are taking place all the time. And as much as updates are great in the sense that, I mean, security is a huge one. Mm-hmm. You have to make sure that your servers are secure. And every time there's a vulnerability that somebody has found, well, quickly a patch needs to come out in the form of an update to go ahead and make it secure again. But the downside to having all these updates is, well, every time you update your system, you're messing with it, you're changing it, you're running the risk of damaging it. And that's a scary thing, especially for some of us that go back to like the Windows NT days. I wouldn't even make a joke. But there really, I will tell you, there was an update that pretty much went out and anybody who installed it, they didn't have a server anymore. Now, not totally 100%. I mean, there was a fix. You were able to undo it, and, but it was a lot of work.
It's called a learning experience. Always test your patches before you put it on production servers. So.
Yes.
And I'm so very unsympathetic. I'm going, that'll teach you.
No, you definitely want to test everything out, and that's where WSUS is going
to
really help you out, is it gives you that ability, rather than just have automatically everything comes down and gets installed, you can have everything come down, get put in place in a test environment, and once you are confident that an update is safe, it is secure, it's pretty much a click of a button, you approve it, and boom, it goes out to all of your servers, all of your clients, anyone you want to have updated.
Yeah. And for the context of the 411 exams, you always want to make sure that you understand your options within this particular tool. Things like you can group computers. Certain computers, maybe, for example, laptop users, they never come to work at 3 o'clock in the morning where you like to push out the patches. So you might create a different group for them and have them follow a different schedule.
I like understanding pushing out patches at 3 in the afternoon. What do you mean 3 in the morning?
Not interrupting their work and so forth.
Yeah.
They don't work. They won't notice. Yeah, it's coffee break.
Our time's more important.
Yeah, right. I want to see how that goes, right? So, okay, so making sure that your options, configuration settings, and how to set this up, and also Ed just mentioned that you what kind of patches you approve through and deploy. So not only need to know what WSUS is, moving up to the earlier topic, which is deploying mass amount of clients or even servers, knowing what these acronym stands for is one thing, but knowing what they do and what are some of the features and what are your options for changing the settings, how it impacts your network, it's also really relevant for this. And this will be great for if you have a test lab to try this out, just to see what it looks like. I'm a big one for visual, so if I've ran through the labs in a study environment, you may not have servers to work with. Maybe you had to use virtual servers. Maybe you're using Microsoft Virtual Academy to look at some of the screenshots or look at some of the simulations. That image of the dialog box is in your mind. When you're facing an exam situation, you know exactly what your options are because you can see it in your head.
Yeah, absolutely. And I will tell you, if you take WDS and WSUS, and you kind of have them working in conjunction with one another. Speaking of patch management, you also have the ability to get your patches out to offline servers as well.
Yes, patch your images.
You know, because could you imagine you have a backup image, you have an offline server, it's not getting any updates, you have a need to bring that server online, that's a lot of work. I mean, that's a lot of time spent doing those updates and more patches and updates. Well, now we have the ability, and it's not brand new. This is something that we did see in Windows Server 2008. But again, little by little, things get a little easier, get a little better. But we now have the ability to keep our offline servers updated as well. Mm-hmm. Now, there's one other area of deploying, managing, and maintaining servers. And as much as, like I said, I'm a quiet guy. I don't like to talk. I am gonna throw this back at Cynthia, and here's specifically
here's
why.
Here's the ball, toss.
Yeah, it's about monitoring.
Right.
And so here's the thing. I spend a lot of my time, the majority of my time, in a classroom or teaching this stuff. And to be quite frank, and if you've ever been in the classroom learning about monitoring, it's not the most exciting material.
It's not?
No, unfortunately, it's not in the classroom. And the reality is because it's, you don't have those real world tangibles. Even if I'm giving you a real world scenario that I've experienced, you're not experiencing it. You're not experiencing the excitement and the benefit that you get from monitoring your servers.
Right.
I'll never forget going back to the days of NT, sitting for 5 days, three of those five, it was a five-day class, three
the
of the days, and nothing
class,
but monitoring. Yeah. And you just, But Cynthia, on the other hand,
I get to see this stuff on a daily basis.
This is what
she
does.
Isn't that
so
fun?
I'm going to let her talk about it a little bit here.
So what we want to look at for 4.11 is not only understanding that, you know, performance monitoring doesn't sound like an exciting thing. In a real-world application, it's really helpful in the production environment, understanding how your server is doing. And we already mentioned that in a test environment, it's not so exciting because there's no activity on your server, no real activity. You're not really sure what you're observing. For the test purposes, even if you review things like what kind of objects you can observe, which instances you can observe, what type of counters to look at, what type of threshold you're looking for when you're monitoring some of these counters, but understand how they apply in the actual environment is great. You don't need to memorize thresholds, not likely, but some of the main ones you do need to understand. For example, if you're seeing your CPU pushing 70 consistently, probably not a good thing.
No.
But knowing that you can monitor that, and you can even create thresholds to trip to send out alerts and so forth. So that functionality is there. Understanding the graphic interface of how to configuring it, how to create a data collection set, how to set these settings, how to navigate inside the management console to do things like changing the scale, highlighting the performance lines so you can have a better visual of understanding your server, how they're doing. My favorite thing to do with performance monitoring is creating the initial baseline. Then you understand in the future how your server is doing.
That's that buzzword I do know.
Baseline.
Being in the class.
Yeah.
It's all about the baseline.
It's all about the baseline.
It's all about that starting point so you have something to compare against.
That's right.
And I can tell you, you know, it's not that I have no real world experience. I do get out there and do some of this stuff.
It's just not as much fun.
Yeah, well, but the baseline is so important because when somebody comes and says, hey, my system's running slow, my question really to them always is slow compared to what?
To what? Yeah.
Right? Because slow is relevant. Mm-hmm. Or relative, I should say.
Relative.
It's not relevant. Is it relevant? I don't know.
It's kind of relative. But
so,
it's definitely relative.
Yeah, it's relative. And so having that baseline allows you to see, okay, what component is slow compared to back when we took the baseline. Mm-hmm. The other thing I can tell you real fast, there is actually, I'll take 30 seconds here to tell you a funny story of, to just give you the idea of the everyday administrator versus just the typical learner in a classroom, is the event logs. I'll never forget the day I'm sitting in class and we're talking about, I'm not the one sitting, I'm not the student, I'm the instructor in the class, and we're talking about the event logs and we're talking about best practices, look at your event logs every day and do this and that. And everyone in the room is kind of laughing, going, yeah, like anyone actually does that. And one guy goes, and he's just sitting quiet. He didn't say a word.
That's his job.
And that's what I do. Every day, my day starts at 6 a.m. I go in at 5 a.m. and that's all I do for the first hour is look at event logs. And guess what? His servers run better than anybody else's servers in that company. He did work for a very large company, who I will leave nameless, but a very large company. And he was somebody who was really praised for spending that extra hour every morning going through the event logs.
Mm-hmm. And knowing the event viewer, knowing what file extension your event logs come out as, knowing which tool to monitor, and of course, our default list of event logs changed from, you know, several versions before, so understanding which event logs are default when you're presented maybe with options of which log you would look at for tracking users' logon activities. Do you look at app log? Do you look at system log? Do you look at security? These type of things, so understand what these logs are for. The other thing is, guess what? all the tools we use for physical machines are exactly the same when you're monitoring virtual machines. So as we're moving forward to virtualization, Hyper-V, which we'll talk about later on, you're using the same tools. So look at how your VMs are doing.
Yeah, virtual machines, physical machines, all the same.
Yeah,
getting closer and closer.
Still need to be watching. Yeah.
All right. So, as to not, you know, bore me too much with this monitoring.
I'm not crazy bored. I'm just counter kidding. Watching woman.
Let's move into another objective here.
Yeah.
Where we have configuring file and print services.
Oh, print services. That's real exciting.
Can't get much more exciting than print services.
No, printers.
Come
yes.
on. Printers are really exciting.
Right.
You know why they're exciting? Because they just work. Except for they just work.
They do
except
work.
Except for when they don't.
Yeah, except for
and then when they don't, they become your worst nightmare. So really, I have to tell you, when it comes to configuring file and print services, again, and you're going to hear us say this, you know, we've already said it, and you're going to hear us say it again, but these are the same, they look like the same objectives that we saw in the 410 exam, okay? But now we're talking about configuring. We have things installed. Now we're going to get a little bit more, just a hair more advanced. And some people don't even look at it as advanced. The 411 is not more advanced, but it's different. We're talking about configuring. Mm-hmm. And so when it comes to file services, we talk about things like DFS, the distributed file system, okay? So rather than just talk about the basic, simple file share, now we're talking about distributed file system, where we in the
enterprise. I like to call it the one-stop shop.
The one-stop shop. Just go look for that one share, and it doesn't matter
That's
where
right.
it is in
it
your enterprise.
It points all sorts of different servers.
Find it for you. That's absolutely correct. And then how about the file and server resource manager? You were talking about, you know, we were just talking about printers,
that.
And when they work, great, but when they don't, it becomes your worst nightmare.
Yeah. Especially when you have multiple items to have to monitor for and have to watch for managing, that could get a little bit painful. Things like even in the file system when we talk about, you know, monitoring quotas back in the day, when you set quotas per volume, well, now you're not just having multiple volumes per server, you now have multiple servers, multiple virtual machines. You have all of these add together to manage them on a day-to-day basis, to administer them properly. It's great to have a good tool.
Yeah,
and this is where we're.
And this is a new tool.
Yes,
a fairly new tool. Is anything
that made it easier?
Once again,
that's what I love about some of these tools we go through in 2012. Is some of the features they're not brand new technically. They kind of peeked their heads through in 2008 or 2008 R2. But the fact that it made it easier for us to manage them. So for the exam purposes, knowing what the new interface looks like. I cannot stress that enough.
Yep,
understanding what the
helpful.
GUI is like.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and they feel new.
They feel new
because
maybe
there wasn't a very friendly interface back in 2008.
Yeah, you kind of ignored it.
Right.
That's possible.
And you're not alone. I mean, there's a lot of people who ignored it, and you know, the good news is Microsoft saw that, Microsoft listened and made a great interface, and that's part of what's so exciting about Windows Server 2012.
Right.
Now, another component of file and print services comes down to encryption.
Encryption.
Now,
oh,
we kind of have an old school and an older school? Because really, when it comes to encryption, it's not brand new stuff.
Mm-hmm.
It's not even, I don't even know if it falls into what we were just talking about as far as stuff that wasn't used, because this stuff
that
has
was
been used.
Mm-hmm.
But the older school would be EFS, the encrypting file system, been around since Windows 2000.
Mm-hmm.
Even though it's been around since Windows 2000, and Cynthia mentioned this at the very beginning of this session, you still have to make sure, especially if you're somebody who has worked with these prior operating systems, you have to go back and make sure you know the basics. These exams, I mean, unless you're gonna take the 417 and do an upgrade, each of these exams are looking at it as this could be the first time you're working with a Windows Server operating system. So make sure you know EFS. And EFS was tricky for a lot of people. And one reason is because it was being explained inaccurately in the very beginning because it was so confusing even to some of the experts.
Yeah, so new.
And I will tell you that you want to understand the difference between things like symmetric key encryption and public key encryption or asymmetric key encryption and make sure that you understand how those work and how EFS can help you out at the file system level.
Mm-hmm.
But then, you know, I know that BitLocker is something you use every day. So
brilliant. Yeah, moving on to BitLocker, whether it's file-based or disk-based, you want to make sure you understand, well, not only the functionality of it. So understand if you're presented with a requirement, for example, you're the administrator of an organization and you have the need to make sure all laptops, when they're lost or stolen, the content on the laptop is not also compromised. Hardware can be replaced, information bad idea to let it loose in the wild. So BitLocker becomes very useful. And then we're looking to things like the difference between the file level encryption and the disk level, how you can make sure that this laptop, without using decryption code, which you come up with a certificate ahead of time, you can even boot the laptop. You can do as far as that. And things like removable drive as well, they become very applicable. So understanding that those features are there and understanding configuration. Which tool would you use and how would you set it up?
Absolutely. And you know, you mentioned about hardware can be replaced. Mm-hmm. Data, not so much.
Iffy.
Yeah, and I can say there's a saying that we used to always say, which is real simple. Just if you're gonna get, you know, I would talk to people who were looking to break into the IT field, and it was one simple saying. And we would talk about it a little bit more when it came to like backup and recovery, but mm-hmm. it also holds true on security, which is you lose data, you lose job.
Yeah.
Simple as that.
That's right.
Data is everything, all right?
Yes.
So the information is everything. And yeah. So you want to make sure that it's secure. That's not something to take lightly at all.
Mm-hmm.
So now there is one final component to this area of the objectives, and that is setting up audit policies.
Oh, good old auditing.
Yes, auditing.
Audit trail, yes.
Auditing is something, again, that has been around for a long, long time. Mm-hmm. It's been around pretty much as long as servers have been around,
yes.
as long as Microsoft servers have been around. And the audit policies are so important to make sure that you set up properly. You need to make sure that you understand that you are auditing things, not people. That's one of the keys that a lot of people get real hung up on, is you don't want to audit an individual. You can, like technologically, mm-hmm. in the operating system, you can do it,
mm-hmm.
but it's not a good practice. Good practice is you audit looking for certain activities, looking for certain things to show up. A perfect example of where you don't want to audit a person, you don't want to audit an individual person, is if you think somebody's doing something, so you start watching them. The problem is you can end up having the blinders on. You're looking just at that one person when right over here is the person who's actually doing it. Whereas instead of looking at the person, if you look for the activity,
yes.
it's going to show you who's doing it. And that's the cool thing about auditing in Windows Server 2012 is it tells you everything. It tells you who did it, what they did, where they did it, when they did it. I could almost refer to, for anybody who goes back to the days of Welcome Back, Kotter, I could say it's almost like the Vinnie Barbarino.
Oh, my goodness. You're really showing
myself,
your age there.
Yeah,
yes.
the Vinnie Barbarino of Windows Server 2012. You know who, what.
What.
So,
of course, I feel bad I actually understood that reference.
Yeah.
Never mind.
Say,
erase
I guess
that.
I dated you.
Yeah, that's
you
right.
understood that. So, but I will tell you, there's one key audit policy mm-hmm. that has always been really important to understand. It works just a hair different than the rest of them, and that is auditing object access. So when it comes to actually like who's accessing your files and folders or your resources, it's a two-step process. Whereas everything else, we'll learn. You know, when you look into auditing, you'll see basically do it through group policy.
Mm-hmm.
You have your group policy settings, and there's a term. You know, again, shouldn't be new to you, and it's something that'll come up in these objectives. But when you set up auditing, you do it through group policy settings. But object access is set up in two places. You have mm-hmm. to enable it in the group policy. But then you also have to make sure that you go to the individual files and folders, mm-hmm. whatever the resources may be that you want to be auditing that particular object, and enable it there as well.
Yes.
And that's
two-step process usually catches people.
All the time.
Yeah. Can you imagine you have to describe that two-step process? You have the giant master switch turn on to say, hey, we're going to audit from now on. Then the second step is the detail stuff.
Yep.
What
yep.
you're actually auditing.
Yeah. And I guess the one other thing that I will mention about auditing is, again, similar to almost like to stay focused on auditing activities and auditing things as opposed to auditing people, you also want to pay very close attention to auditing successes versus failures.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. You have the opportunity to go ahead.
Next I need
session,
to learn that language.
Next session, Cynthia will teach me how to speak.
Yeah.
But anyway, you go ahead and you audit the success. Somebody actually accessed a file. But you also might want to audit the failure, meaning somebody tried and didn't get in to access that file. And that's really important to pay attention to, because it might be better to detect that somebody's trying to do something before they succeed in doing it.
So from the context of 411 exam, you really want to look at questions and see what the goal is, what the objective is. Are they looking to see if someone was trying to access a particular resource? Then what Ed just said is exactly what you're looking for in the answers in the perhaps the multiple choice to see which option is the closest to achieving the objective.
Absolutely. Yeah. Should we move along to the next section?
Yeah, let's take a look at the next section. Okay, this is going to be the network services and access.
Ooh, network services.
Yeah, the fun stuff.
Woohoo! I think it's fun. Most people think it's dry. I think it's great.
It's a big topic.
Yeah, it is a big topic.
Because you can't just lump it all up and say, network services, great. What does that mean? Well, there's a lot more than just whoops. This is what happens when you hit the whether you hit the key accidentally. Let's go back to individual network services, things such as the DNS, such as your VPN, what we're going to look at later on. So in 4.10, we talked about installing the role of DNS. Mm-hmm. Now we're looking at configuring. So configuring DNS based on what you're looking for, sort of understanding the terminology such as creating zones, configuring zones, service records. I mentioned there's forward lookup and reverse lookup, understanding when to use them, and understanding some of the most common records. For example, understand what SOA record is, understand what MX record is. So these are the things that pay attention to. SOA, yeah.
It's SOA, it's spelled SOA, right?
SOA, yeah. SOA record.
Start of authority, right?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, and matter of fact, speaking of the records, you know, something we did talk about in the 410 is we talked about the support for IPv6 and knowing about our AAAA records or our quad A or our
record.
Or I guess it would be the records. So you have to understand for this, to bring it into the context of the 411 exam, we want to make sure that you are paying very close attention to the individual records and what they each mean. You have your A and your quad A records, which are your very typical forward lookup, as Cynthia just mentioned. You also then have your PTR record, which is the reverse lookup.
Pointer records.
That Cynthia just mentioned. The start of authority. You have your other SRV resource records to support Active Directory. You have your
NS records.
Well, there's one record in particular I can't believe that you didn't like just jump on immediately, which would be your MX record.
I did mention that.
All right.
Very briefly.
Oh, see,
I was trying to
so the MX
sneak
record
it in a little bit.
For mail.
Exchange, mail exchange.
Right. Mm-hmm. So for your exchange servers.
Yeah.
So you really want to make sure you pay attention. And then as far as the zones, in 4.10 we learned about installing the basic installation and configuring of the zones, just getting them going, whereas now we have to talk about things like zone transfers.
Yes.
Right? In the enterprise, we have more than, we don't want to have just one little DNS server supporting the entire company. So we have to make sure that we know how to get the information from one DNS server to the other DNS servers.
Right.
So you have to understand the difference between primary and secondary, Active Directory integrated.
Yeah.
We also have dynamic updates, right? Getting the information.
The
in the old days, you sit there on the keyboard, you go over to the DNS server, all right, a new computer has been added to our network, let's add it in. Now it's all dynamic, but we also have secure dynamic updates.
You know, the funny thing is, I have to say, my very, very first internship was to update DNS records.
Nice.
That was way back when.
And she thought I did.
And you know what the fun, I know.
Hotter.
It's like, whoo. And the funnier thing is, I'm dyslexic. Getting me to update DNS records. Yeah, let's spell the words wrong.
Were they Z
Anyways.
Records then? Shows you how much I know about dyslexia.
Yeah,
but
yeah, that's right. Anyways, so DNS record is there, and you also want to look at things like you already mentioned zone transfer.
Yep.
Zone delegation, understand configuring them, what it actually means. So you're designing not just individual DNS server. You're looking at DNS server, how it interacts with other DNS servers.
Yep, like forwarding.
Yep, forwarding.
Conditional forwarding.
Yeah.
Oh, and wait a minute, we can't forget stub zones.
Oh, good old stub zones.
Have to know about stub zones.
Yes.
So I guess, since I can't give you the whole lesson right now, I'll give you the one-line answer to a stub zone. Dynamic delegation. If you know what a DNS delegation is, stub zone automates it. It makes it dynamic.
Even less work for you as administrator.
So it's actually, we cringe at stub zones because people have had a hard time understanding it over the years. But the reality is that it's a great thing.
Yeah.
You should understand how it works.
Yeah. Understand, of course, the graph. I keep going back to understand the tool, understand the graphic interface, know where to right-click and make changes to the settings. And, of course, along the same reasoning, we're also looking at you can still deal with tools such as DNS CMD tool, look at PowerShell commands, all of that is in there. So in this 4.11 context, understanding your all available tools and what you can do with each of these tools, what kind of tasks you can accomplish.
Yeah, and then moving outside of DNS, we can also move into VPNs and routing,
remote access.
Different remote access solutions.
Yeah. And my favorite remote access feature, direct access.
Yeah, I was gonna say, like segue, but kind of not.
Yeah, kind of.
That's where I was heading with it.
I was just going to rub it in there.
That's the one new thing.
Yeah.
Although it's not new.
Not brand new.
Right? We had it in Server 2008.
But much easier.
Actually, even Server 2008.
Yeah, that's right.
But what we didn't use it. It wasn't so much that it's not just that it's easier, but there was one very specific reason direct access was just not used. It's a great, great way to replace your VPN solution. Mm-hmm. The reason it wasn't used is because in Windows Server 2008, it required the dreaded IPv6. And that's not me saying it's the dreaded IPv6, but that's what the administrators were saying. The level of configuration for direct access was great enough to begin with. Mm-hmm. But then to have to implement an IPv6 network to boot made it that much more difficult. Now, I will tell you, direct access in Windows Server 2012, you want to use IPv6 if you have the means to do so, but it's not a requirement anymore, which I think is huge. And I think we're going to see a lot more direct access in place.
Right. And it helps end users so that when they're connecting to their resources in their organization, they don't have to remember to launch the VPN client. Put in their information. Direct access is looking at their logon credentials and automatically connecting. And also, this gets into the next topic we're talking about, is how do you make sure that only users with the correct level of patches or virus antivirus software is able to connect. So this is also part of
that,
the direct
and that is our next objective. Yeah. And this is a perfect...
You like how I just move into
they
that?
They are. Well, and it's not just how we segued into it, but really, I mentioned in the 410, and I'll even mention again here in the 411, that we have the... Active Directory and group policy are kind of looked at as being one large arena,
they're
even though it's separated here.
They're together.
Well, here, network services and access, and then the next thing that we have here, which is network policy server infrastructure, also relate together. Because, and you pretty much summed it up. I mean, there's not a lot more to say about it. There are a few specifics. There's a lot of terminology, like radius, you should be familiar with, and NAP. You know, every time I hear that acronym, I know what I think I plan on doing. It's NAT time.
Yeah.
So, but no, network access protection. And the whole idea here is being able to make sure, as you were just saying, that the people who are, and not just the human people, but the clients, the client machines that are coming into your network, that they meet the criteria that your company requires to keep your network safe.
Right.
Make sure they're patched, the antivirus. This could be for remote access. This could also be for wireless access. Right?
Or mobile clients.
People that just came
into your network with their laptop. They're visiting the corporate headquarters. They plug into the wall.
BYOD.
You don't know what's on there. Yeah. Bring your own. Nice. Okay.
Was that funny? I never know when I tell a joke.
We're always controlling the environment that's connecting in. So. Also, part of this is, again, remember your tools, how you will configure them. Know what they do is one benefit, but knowing how to configure, how to enable it, what are some of the settings you could use. For example, you can set a health file to know that this is the level that clients have to meet before they're able to connect to the network resource. And if they don't meet that requirement, what type of action would you take? Would you remediate that, or would you just block them all out, just leave them in quarantine?
Put them in quarantine.
Yeah, just leave it. Don't care. They don't get any access.
And the remediation that you just mentioned is huge in the fact that, again, if we kind of go back to the old days, if somebody wanted to come in and you were able to detect that they did not meet the criteria, even though this was much more manual, the detection was. The fixing was as well. It was one of those where basically, well, you don't meet the criteria.
Now what?
Deal with it.
Yeah, that's right.
Now, with the network policy servers, you have the ability to not, when a client doesn't meet the criteria, they can be sent to a remediation server, a remediation solution.
Bring them up to the level.
Yeah, maybe get them in contact with the WSUS server. Again, redundant. But the WSUS server, which will go ahead and help them to get patched, get up to date. And then they can get into your network without you ever having to be involved, meaning you, the human, you, the IT administrator, without you having to get a phone call. This can all happen automatically on the client end. Yeah. So it's some great stuff. Yeah. And then we also have centralization, mm-hmm. right? Whereas that's another issue we used to have is the inconsistencies between a remote access server over here and a remote access server over here. And I know
and the that, different policies that could be on them.
Yeah, exactly.
You can find
you have
a
different
loophole.
Administrators mm-hmm. setting up this one, setting up this. Now we can go ahead and have centralized policies that all remote access servers throughout the organization are all going to work with.
Right. And you brought out a really good point, especially in the context of 411 exams. When you mm-hmm. look at these topics and when you get a question about it, it might help to draw things out. I personally like to visualize, so I like to draw little circles, say, okay, I got a VPN server here, I have a Radius client, I have a Radius server, and drawing lines across. So understanding how the question is laid out, you can answer it better. So you know what they're asking for. They're asking for a setting that's on the Radius client, or you're looking at a setting on the Radius server.
So. Yeah. Well, I find that Visio can really be your friend.
Just not during exam,
not
right?
Not during the exam, but when mm-hmm. when you are learning this stuff,
yes.
Visio can be your friend to mm-hmm. draw out these nice diagrams without mm-hmm. them having, if you've seen my penmanship, you know you don't want to see me drawing anything out. But yes, when you get into the exam room.
You probably don't want to play Pictionary with you, right?
Yeah, well.
Everything
no,
is a circle in the line.
You do not want to play Pictionary with me. Yeah. What is this?
Yeah.
And I will tell you that, and this is, you know, we'll talk about exam tips and tricks at the very mm-hmm. end here, but that is a perfect exam mm-hmm. tip. Is the idea of if you have some of these diagrams in your head and you've been playing with them, when you get into the exam, you can't bring those notes with you.
Mm-hmm.
But what you can do is you're given either scratch paper or a dry erase board.
Mm-hmm.
First thing when you sit down, if that's something that helps you,
right.
draw it out.
Yeah, draw it out.
It's a great tip. It's a great, great tip.
Yeah. So let's take a look at our next topic, one of your favorite.
One of our favorite.
Uh-huh. Coming from Exchange side, we love Active Directory. We need Active Directory. Oh no, we need Active Directory.
Oh, okay. Glad you cleared that up.
Yeah, we can't live without Active Directory.
So configuring and managing Active Directory, again, just to kind of change the context from 4.11, from 4.10, I should say. In 4.10, we were installing and configuring Active Directory. Now we're mm-hmm. I know the word configure is still there, but mm-hmm. we're configuring and managing Active Directory. And one of the key things here when it comes to service authentication mm-hmm. is group managed service accounts. That is the buzzword of the day in this arena, is the group managed service accounts. We had managed service accounts. We've had service accounts going back to forever.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, and this was the idea of having an actual account that a service or an application would log in as in order to perform its functionality.
What, I'm not using an administrator account? Come on.
I do.
Yeah.
No. And
password.
Well, yeah.
Giving away the secrets.
You're going to make me lose data and then lose job. So anyway, no, back in the day, you know, mm-hmm. yeah, we would either use the administrator account or we would just create some other account and mm-hmm. call it an administrative level account. But then password would need to be reset on it, and then suddenly some function wasn't working anymore. And so then we moved into these managed service accounts where that password would get updated automatically.
Mm-hmm.
The problem was with these managed service accounts is you had to have a separate account for every separate service, for every separate function. Nobody was using it. I'll never forget that I just recently sat in a session with Dean Wells from Microsoft. He's with the Active Directory group, and there had to have been, if I'm guessing, I mean, a few hundred people in the room. And he asked, how many of you in Windows Server 2008 were using service accounts? Or I should say managed service accounts.
Cricket chirp.
Guess what?
Chirp.
None of these went up. Nobody was using it. Well, the good news is that now in Windows Server 2012, with the group managed service accounts, we now have the ability to go ahead and simplify that process and actually make this really cool thing that was created in Windows Server 2008 usable.
Mm-hmm.
So, and which, by the way, I will tell you, I will throw a small little plug out there. If any of this stuff in Active Directory, some of these new features with Active Directory are of interest to you, that session that I referred to, there is a recorded version from Dean Wells, and it's a phenomenal session. I recommend you go. I don't have a link for it, but I recommend you go out there and search for it. You learn a lot.
Mm-hmm.
All right, so what else do we have here with Active Directory? We have our domain controllers.
the good old DCs. And what's an RODC?
RODC. That's just fun to say.
Yeah.
It's a read-only domain controller. Again, yes. Not new. Got to go
not
back
new.
To the basics.
Not new.
It's been around for a while. It's a security thing. It's a efficiency of resource thing. Mm-hmm. It's just what it sounds like.
Yeah.
It doesn't have a master copy. It doesn't have a read-write copy.
It doesn't even have a complete copy.
That's right. It doesn't even have a complete copy.
Yeah.
That's right.
So that's important.
All the passwords are not stored in this copy. Mm-hmm. Only the passwords that are needed for maybe a branch office, mm-hmm. maybe a small branch office that only has a few users.
Mm-hmm.
Well, that's where your read-only domain controller. How about your FSMOs? That's
FSMOs.
That's my favorite one to say.
The FSMO. Flexible single mesh. Yes.
It's a
good old thing.
Yeah, I date myself again. It reminds me of that movie Gremlins and Gizmo. I always think of Gizmo with FSMO.
Yeah, that word used to just gives me the giggle fits.
It just sounds
so weird.
FSMO?
Yeah, FSMO.
It's funny that you say that. I actually had a student who did giggle every time we'd say the word FSMO.
FSMO,
and anytime our class
FSMO.
Got dry and boring,
you just go,
my classes never get dry and boring,
yeah.
is if she was in the class, just out of the blue, I'm talking about DNS, mm-hmm. and I would just go, FSMO!
Yeah.
She'd giggle. So now all that kidding aside, mm-hmm. you have
know
to
your FSMO
you
rules.
You have to absolutely
yes.
know your FSMOs. You have to know that you have your five.
What are
you
gonna, I don't want to use two hands.
Or
five.
Patty cake?
Five.
Or
yeah, no.
But no, there's five, mm-hmm. but more specifically, there are two forest-wide FSMOs mm-hmm. and your three
and
domain FSMOs.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so you have to make sure you know that.
Yeah, know where to, you don't have to configure it. Usually, by default, the first domain controller of the forest pick up the forest level roles and also the domain level roles for that forest domain, root domain.
Mm-hmm.
And then every single other domains coming after it, the first DC will pick up the three domain level roles, but understand what they are, understand what level they're at, and also understand which tool would you use to transfer these roles. You can do it through command line, you can do it through graphic interface, but understanding what happens when maybe one of the FSMOs is not available, what are the symptoms? So things to think about, definitely.
Yeah. What else we have? We have things like Universal Group membership caching.
Caching is a good thing. Universal Group has been throwing, not a new feature, but it's been throwing people off in production environment where performance is a concern.
Mm-hmm.
You don't want to instantly trigger off a replication across the environment when you're just adding another member into the Universal Group.
Right. Although I will mention one thing, and that is mm-hmm. that The original purpose of this Universal Group membership caching was if you had, let's say, a branch office mm-hmm. that you did not want to put a global catalog server. There's
yes.
another term you
mm-hmm.
mentioned earlier. You don't want to put the global catalog server, or GC, out mm-hmm. in that office. And the reason was because, again, maybe a slow link, mm-hmm. and you don't want to deal with the replication. Here's the really good news, though. It's good news for all of us as a whole. It's good news for the global catalog servers. It's bad news for Universal Group membership caching mm-hmm. is that replication of the global catalog is so much more efficient now in
yes.
Windows Server 2012 that you might just go ahead and put a global catalog server in every branch office
right.
and be fine. But if you come across that scenario where it's still causing a problem, that's where Universal Group membership caching will come in handy.
You gotta, take care of those satellite offices. Maybe.
I suppose. If I have to.
Yeah. They don't belong to the company, do they? They're satellite.
Yeah, and then, I noticed there's another real fun topic here that mm-hmm. we always love to talk about, which is when it comes to maintenance, mm-hmm. Backup and recovery of Active Directory.
Right.
Now, it's not so much backup and recovery of Active Directory is the, another sleeper.
Do I really need to back that
right.
up?
Right. It's, in general, backup and recovery. People are like, we know. We got to back up our stuff. You lose data, you lose job.
Mm-hmm.
Well, here's the deal. When it comes to backup and recovery, it's not just about running backups, mm-hmm. right, and knowing how to do this a restore.
Right.
We now have a whole lot of solutions to choose from. We have the Active Directory Recycle Bin, just to make it
go
back to
bin.
A real simple. We had that in Windows Server 2008 R2, but you had to deal with it through ADSI Edit, ADSI mm-hmm. Edit. Mm-hmm. Not a fun tool. Now we have a nice, friendly GUI interface to help us out with that. And along those same lines, not to get off base, but another thing we are going to talk about here is the password settings objects.
Yes.
Having the ability to go ahead and have password policies for not just on the domain level. Mm-hmm. You can go into individual groups and set a different password policy for that group.
Mm-hmm.
It was a feature available in Windows Server 2008 mm-hmm. R2, but you had to do it through ADSI Edit. Now we have a graphical user interface. So now, real quick, jumping back to backup and recovery, we also have Active Directory snapshots. Matter of fact, another huge one, and this is the one where, again, I'll refer you to Dean Wells' session, is now being able to virtualize your domain controllers. Because if, now, that, you know, in Windows Server 2008, it was not good practice to virtualize your domain controllers. Those were supposed to be physical machines. And the reason is because, and I could do 2 75-minute sessions just on this one topic alone, but you have things called the USN bubbles that would be created. And these are problems if you went and rolled back to a snapshot of a virtual machine that was a domain controller. That is all resolved now in Windows Server 2012. And you're going to want to understand how that technology works and understand how to use that to your advantage. Because when it comes to backup recovery, well, how easy is it now to have a virtualized domain controller? And if you need to recover it,
yeah, bring the image back.
Snapshot. Not Active Directory snapshot. A virtual machine snapshot. Great, great, great way to do it. Now, the other thing, the last thing when we talk about Active Directory here is when it comes to these account policies. I already started to mention with the password setting objects, right?
Yeah, the lockout policies, the password policies,
account
all
lockout,
that fun stuff.
Yeah, you notice we're saying that.
Yeah, I was like,
this is not new. Okay, that's the one thing you need to understand. This is not new. This is a getting back to the basics. So, you know, there's not a ton to say there other than make sure that if this is old news to you, I mean, if it's new, great. Learn it, make sure you're solid on it. If it's old to you because you've been dealing with the password policies and the account lockout policies and all that, make sure you're solid on it. And remember that the new password setting objects.
Yeah, it's not just domain only. And that used to throw people off a lot, even though you have the option to configure. It looks like a domain policy on the password set for every single GPO, but only one of them worked.
You know, small piece of trivia, I don't know if you know this or not, but did you know that password settings and account lockout settings, even going all the way back to Windows 2000, they did not have to be done only at the domain level? They could be done, well, no, I'm saying even if you could do it on a specific organizational unit, but it would only affect local user accounts.
Yeah.
That is something that a lot of people got tripped up on, but it is something you need to know is that you, even besides our password setting objects, you can actually set them at the organizational unit level, but only a local user account will be affected by it.
Right. Because the domain level
piece
just
of trivia
run over.
That not a lot of people are familiar with.
But now we know that we have the PSO, the password.
PSOs are awesome.
Yeah, setting object.
It's not even just awesome to say. They're just awesome.
PSO.
PSOs and the Active Directory Recycle Bin are two of the most, you know, just exciting features as far as I'm concerned. When they came out, Windows Server 2008 R2, when it was part of that release, I was so excited only to be so let down. Because it was
such high
easy
hopes
to use.
Yeah.
Now it's
but
easy
I was
to
still
use.
Glad that it was the option was there.
Yeah.
But you just had to learn how to fiddle with it.
Well, now it's easy.
Now it's much easier. You have the option, you can implement it easily. Know your interface again.
Yeah. And you know, and earlier we talked about a couple of objectives that go together. Well, here we have another couple, and there's almost like this
That's a great segue again. Yes.
Is we talk about the account policy settings. Well, those are part of group policy settings.
Which
and
leads
that
us to
is
the next slide.
Objective that we have here. And it's actually our last objective, which is configuring and managing group policy. And again, I'm going to beat the dead horse
topic.
Here. In 4.10, we talked about implementing it. Now we're talking about configuring and managing group policy. And it is so, so important that you understand the actual processing order. I mentioned this in our 4.10 session. LSDOU. No LSDOU. Local, site, domain, organizational unit. And technically, you know, it's LSDOU, OU, 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 OU because you have a hierarchy of your IOUs. No, your OUs. But even beyond that, make sure that you're real solid on block inheritance, enforced. Make sure you know about slow link policies so that maybe certain things don't get affected if you're over a slow link.
Yeah, like installing Office.
That's fun over slow link.
Right.
Loopback processing. That's yes. a big one. The loopback mm-hmm. processing, making it so that say you had a kiosk. Mm-hmm. I can't even say the word kiosk system. Where mm-hmm. I don't care what user logs in, you want the computer the policy to be the same mm-hmm. across the board every time. What else do we have in the way of exceptions? We have WMI filters.
Yes.
There's so
Very
many.
Handy.
It's like I'm yeah. like drawing a blank.
So
almost
to do,
so many.
Yes.
I mean, like, getting excited. I
yeah,
love
that's
the
right.
policy.
But understand, you know, understand the anatomy of a GPO too. You have your user portion, you have the computer portion. You have to know which gets applied first. And we have multiple that. It's contagious.
It is.
We have multiple group policies, yeah, which applies first. So the LSDOU definitely comes into play. And understanding the local policy, how that plays into it. And the fact that we can have multiple local policy also affects your environment and affects not only your servers, but the clients, the desktop.
Yep,
users.
Absolutely. And I will say there's also, you have your starter GPOs. Mm-hmm. Okay,
yes.
That's something definitely make sure you know about is your starter GPOs so that you can have, it's almost like these templates of GPOs.
I like
so,
that.
Yeah.
Less work for me.
Well, I was gonna say, and this is not something we've discussed, but mm-hmm. I'm speculating with all the work you do with Exchange, mm-hmm. you got to love those starter GPOs for all of your Exchange servers because if you have rules that should be applying to the one, well, maybe they should be applying to the others. And mm-hmm. all those Exchange servers are not always in the same container.
Yeah, you want consistency, and that's what GPO gives
Absolutely.
You.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. You know, there's another big thing with GPOs is the preferences. Mm-hmm. Again, something I mentioned in the 410, but if anything, it's really more in the context of the 411, is your preferences. So you have policies, but now we also have preferences. And again, this is not new. We had this in Windows Server 2008. And the preferences really get into some of the detail of truly getting meticulous about configuring the user's environment. Okay, and being able to do some of those things that you could only do via script mm-hmm. in prior versions of Windows Server. Okay, so
you can be even more of a control freak.
Are you saying I'm a control freak?
Oh, I'm not
Let me
just
talk
saying
a while.
That. Yeah,
Let me
yeah.
talk.
Me, my turn, yeah.
Mine. See, I'll date myself now to the newer movies, right?
Nemo.
Mine. Yeah, so. Anyway, but I think that pretty much sums it up when it comes to the objectives that mm-hmm. we need to deal with. But now, before we wrap this thing up, mm-hmm. let's talk about something that I think is equally as important, maybe even more important, when it comes to really getting ready. You know, if you're watching this right now and you're getting ready to go take a test, we need to give you some of those exam tips and tricks. And you notice I said it nice
experience.
And slow and deliberate so I didn't yeah. stumble through those words. But yeah, so we've been talking about various exam tips as we talk to you about certain topics. Mm-hmm. But here we have some more specific exam tips. There's a few listed here. I'm going to go into a few more, actually, that I like to do.
Definitely.
Cynthia, you'll do
this
some of
your own.
This
is just a talking point. Yeah, just add your
and,
own.
You know, I actually want to say before we even get into this mm-hmm. is that, you know, Cynthia and I are both, we've both been doing this for about the same amount of time. We took our first exams back in the
90s.
Oh, we're old.
Yeah.
And
no, you're old. I never age.
I know. And and we both had a lot of success. Mm-hmm. But what we realized just recently, just yesterday, we were having a casual conversation and we realized we're actually very different in our style and how we get ready for the exam and more specifically how we take the exam, right? Mm-hmm. When we get into yep. that exam room, there is something about us that we learn about each other that's very different. And what's very cool about that is showing all of you who are watching right now mm-hmm. that there are things you'll relate with me and there's things you're going to relate with Cynthia. And that's okay, meaning mm-hmm. you don't have to be the same exact, you know, regimen of, well, this is what Ed told me I have to do if I want to pass the test.
Yeah.
No, I've always said this over the years. You need mm-hmm. to figure out what works for you.
Yeah.
So let's look at some of these tips. Mm-hmm. Before the exam, right, when you're getting ready for the mm-hmm. exam, I love the very first bullet point that we have there, which is set a date. It's all about goal setting. If you just say, I'm going to take the test sometime in the near future. And even if you're as generic, you could be specific to say, I'm going to take it in the next 3 months. That's not specific
enough.
That's
not detailed enough. Yeah.
If I'm going to sit here right now and say, I'm going to take it in 3 months, fine. Then I'm going to look at my calendar and I'm going to go 1, 2, 3 months. That's how long it's going to take me. That's fine. But set the date and actually schedule that test.
Yeah.
schedule it, you're on the hook now. Mm-hmm. I have to be ready to take that test.
And you're
put off forever.
Yeah, if you're anything like me, I can't study without a deadline. I need to know there's a deadline to aim for. If I'm just in the mindset of, oh, I'll take the test when I'm ready, never going to happen.
are you saying you're a procrastinator?
Oh, yeah, definitely. I need to have a set date.
Because I'm the king of procrastination.
Oh, so, yeah? You want to compete on that one?
Well, how about we just agree I'm the king and you're the queen, and they all are, you know.
Sounds good.
Whatever.
Yeah, that's right. Prince and princesses.
I was going to say our jesters, but anyway. So.
Okay.
You're much more, you know, you think.
I'm more diplomatic about it.
Yeah, much more diplomatic about it. So, you want to go ahead and set that big goal of, I'm taking the test by this date. But you also want to set some smaller goals. Mm-hmm. Because, again, if you're anything like me, I'm one of those people that, I kind of need to see that light at the end of the tunnel. I kind of have to know everything or I know nothing. And that works against me. Now, obviously, I figured out how to get past that because I have been doing this a long time and I've passed a lot of tests. But it was a struggle for a long time. I had to learn to set individual goals to say, hey, this week I'm going to master this one objective, this one topic, this one thing that's been nagging me that I don't understand. I heard someone talk about password setting objects, so I'm going to learn that this week. Mm-hmm. Set smaller goals rather than just try to learn everything, because that's, again, why I think that goes with the procrastination, is that's why you feel you're never ready. It's because nobody ever knows everything. Mm-hmm. And that's another key tip that I'm going to kind of add in here is that's okay. You don't have to know everything. The more you know, the better. Mm-hmm. But remember, you only need a 700 to pass the test. You don't need a perfect score. Microsoft is not expecting you to answer every single question correctly if you are going to pass. They realize that no one knows everything. There's not a soul on this planet that can tell you every last thing about. There's some people who think they do.
Unless you want to settle a bet with your friends.
Yeah,
I'm going to get higher score than you.
Yeah, which, by the way, we caution against that. Mm-hmm. I mean, I guess it's all fun if you want to set a bet with your friends and then you go in and say, I got this score, you got that score. Hey, I know more than you.
Yeah.
You know what? Here's the problem. If you and I go in and take the test, same day even, we can go sit in the seats right next to each other in the test center. Different. I may not see the same questions that you do.
That's a very good point, because you know what? It's a big pool of questions that you're getting a subset of that. So one thing is definitely reminding people that, for example, you have to sign off on the NDA. You can't say what's on the exam, but even if you did, it wouldn't help you. So study.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. So just know as much as you know, be as prepared as you can be, but set that date and then just go do it. And you know, that kind of even leads into the next item here we have during the exam. Mm. The first bullet point says don't panic. And it goes right along with what I was just talking about with the, you know, the you don't have to know everything. It's okay to see a question and not know where they pulled that from.
Yeah.
Okay.
And don't let that throw you off.
Move on. Matter of fact, I can take it a step further and tell you that there is not a single exam, and I've taken at least, I don't even know the number, 30, 40 of these exams at least.
It's got to be more than that.
It might be more 90s. Than that at this point. I stopped counting at about 30. That's when I stopped. So I know it's more than 30.
It's
I
when your transcripts start to take pages and pages and pages and pages. It's just like, forget
it. It's kind of like age. I stopped counting how old I was at 30 also. So I know you're not there yet. So you don't have to, you'll see when you get to 30, you stop counting. But really, every single exam, every single one, there was at least one question, at least one, where I just went, where did that come from?
And you know what? For me, that's
that.
Usually the very first question.
The very first. That's great.
It doesn't matter what the question is. The first question, you have that deer caught in the headlight look. And then you ease into it and think, oh.
Well, there's an easy solution for that.
Skip
it's called
it.
The next one.
Yeah, next.
Just skip it and come back later. That's another tip we're going to get into. And I will tell you, by the way, there is another important tip that I kind of skipped over, which is before the exam. Besides the tip about, you know, setting your goals and this and that, also getting your body ready for the exam. Mm-hmm. Get your brain ready for the exam. Always, and I know these are the things you know, you've heard from your school teachers over the years and this and that, but get a good night's sleep. Eat a good meal, make sure you're hydrated. And I will tell you, I had this one nice young lady who came in once. She literally went, because we were a test center as well as a training center. When she was taking out her ID to show me so she could go in and take the exam. I mean, she could like barely even get it out of her wallet because she was shaking so much.
Yeah.
And I talked to her about what was going on, and she just said she was very nervous. Mm-hmm. So I started talking to her about calming her down, and as I'm talking to her to try to calm her down, because I knew she wasn't going to pass. I mean, she was destined to fail. She was so worked up. I come to find that she was so worked up about this test, she hadn't slept the whole night.
Oh.
She didn't eat breakfast.
Not good.
And she had barely had anything to drink. Mm-hmm. So she was now sleep-deprived, malnourished, and dehydrated.
Dehydrated. Oh, not good.
She was going to fail, period. Mm. And I actually refused to let her go into the exam. I this is a true story. I flat out refused. And she got mad at me. She said, you can't stop me. I'm scheduled. I paid my money. And I said, trust me, you are going to thank me later. I refused. I said, you cannot go in. I made her go in the back. I got her some water. I went to the vending machine and I got her some snacks. Once she calmed down, I let her go in. And I found out after the fact. I didn't know this ahead of time because she was just angry at me ahead of time. Afterwards, she did come out and thank me. I didn't actually expect she was going to thank me when I said, you'll thank me later.
Yeah.
She literally thanked me. And the reason is because, I didn't know this, but this was like her sixth shot at that test.
Oh.
She had already failed it 5 times prior. And she thanked me because she realized, wow, that is what I was doing wrong.
All she needed was rest and nourishment.
That's it.
Yeah.
So make sure that you do also take care of your body and your brain when you go for these tests. There's no reason to be this stressed out. If you fail the test, all it means is you have to take it again. That's it. And by the way, your transcript doesn't show when you failed an exam. It only shows when you passed an exam. Mm-hmm. So if you took that test, like for this one lady, when she took it 6 times, her transcript never reflected that. It just showed she passed the test. That's it.
Yeah, whenever you pass the test. Yeah.
Now, I'm going to actually let you talk about the next thing, because this is something that I learned about you.
Right.
Is that when I take the test, I have a very different experience than Cynthia. So I'll let you share about, I go through the test very quickly. I take half the time.
Right.
What do you experience?
Yeah, I just want to talk about that. Some people worry about not having enough time to do these exams, and I want to assure you, you have enough time. In fact, if you know your stuff, you don't have a time problem. If you think about 50 questions, roughly 50 questions.
Wait.
About,
are you saying that when I go through the test, I know my stuff, and that's why
why
I have plenty of time, and you don't, and that's why you run out of time?
If you know your stuff, you shouldn't have time issues. And even if you think about it, if you're evenly dividing it. Time up, 50 questions, maybe 3 minutes per question. Mm-hmm. It doesn't sound like a lot of time. And that fact alone makes some people nervous. When I first started taking the exams, I always thought timing would be an issue. And I realized it's not. Even as I usually tell people that's taking the exam, I read very, very slowly. I'm an ESL. English is my second language. And also, I'm dyslexic. So I have to read slowly in order to not get the questions wrong. I had a couple of nightmare issues where I read the question the first time really quickly, answered it, moved on to the next one. Only upon review, I realized I missed the word not. That changed the whole thing. So read carefully, read slowly. If that's your reading style, that's your comprehension level, definitely you have enough time. And the other thing I like to do is instead of, watch your time, don't waste too much time on one single question. It's a good idea to pass through all of the questions at least once first. So the questions that you know the answer to immediately, select the answer for it and move on. Have at least see through all 50 or roughly 50 questions, you'll be able to have a better idea of answering some of the questions you're unsure of. So there could be a couple of possibilities.
Yeah.
One is you read the question and have no clue what they're asking. And that's a possibility because you will have question with lots of padded information. For example, it's describing the whole network to you, describing the whole organization, what kind of business they're in, not relevant to the question, but it's padding. So able to read through that and just focus on the question itself. That's the first thing. You didn't understand what it's asking. The second one is maybe you understood the question perfectly well. You didn't quite get what the answers are all about. You have maybe 4 multiple choice, and they all look rather close to each other. And you know one of them is the right answer. Just not quite sure which one.
You hope.
Not quite sure which one. So in this case, what I usually do is I will mark the answer I'm most certain about. There's also a mark checkbox on top of the question. Select that and come back to it, visit it later. do not dwell on that question. You could easily waste 10 minutes trying to figure out what this interpretation mean, what that interpretation mean. And it also, you think yourself into a corner.
Right.
You overthink it, and the question's not that complex.
Well, and I will tell you, you know, there is one thing that we do actually agree on, even mm-hmm. though we have a slightly different system because of the needs when we're going through the test.
Right.
We both agree that, see, I just don't answer it. If I answer mm-hmm. a question, I answer it when I'm ready to answer it. Whereas
right.
Cynthia will answer
I will put something
it
down.
And mark it to come back and review later. And yeah. the reason is because you're worried that you might run out of time.
Yes.
And
always
and
give myself that extra.
Right. You want to answer every question. Because
yeah.
a question you don't answer is wrong. You get
yeah.
a zero.
You get a zero.
A question you answer, whether you knew it or not, you might have got it right and you got some points. Mm-hmm. Or you got it wrong and you still got a zero. But you're guaranteed that zero if you don't answer it. Okay?
yeah.
So, but here's what we agree upon, and that mm-hmm. is once you have answered a question, do not ever, with one exception that I'm going to share in a minute,
yeah.
change that answer.
Mm-hmm.
One of the problems, and this is why I don't, even if I'm marking a question to come back to it, I don't like to answer it until I come back, is I have seen that people will answer a question. And then when they go
and
back,
they will
talk
up.
Themselves out
yeah.
of it because you're overthinking
no,
it, and so
yes.
you talk yourself out of that
yeah.
out of that answer. I've as a test proctor, I've mm-hmm. watched people get a lot of answers right, go back and fail the test because they changed all their answers.
Mm-hmm.
Now I said I'd tell you one exception. That one exception is if there is something that's compelling you to do so. As in, sometimes you see a question 3 or 4 questions later, and there's some information in that question that jogs your memory, and a light bulb goes off. And you go, mm-hmm. "Oh, I answered that other one wrong.
Mm-hmm.
I thought I knew, but that's right. I
yeah.
remember that now." That's the only time I ever recommend that you change an answer. Otherwise,
yeah.
you're more likely than not, your gut had the right answer. Your brain starts
overthinking
you into
yes.
the wrong answer.
Yeah.
Because remember, these are the questions, the ones you're going back mm-hmm. to, the ones you weren't sure about.
Yeah.
So your brain didn't necessarily know the right answer.
Right.
So
yeah.
so that's pretty much you know, the tips and tricks
yeah.
that we have for you. Mm-hmm. I know anyone who knows me knows I could talk to you for a whole other hour on tips and tricks on
oh, you
exam
have.
Preparation.
you have done
I
that
have,
before,
so.
Too.
But
there are other previously recorded sessions and, you know.
With my
yeah.
company, but yes.
Yeah.
but anyway, yes, no, before we let you guys go, mm-hmm. we do want to wrap things up. Cynthia, if you want to talk to them about maybe some of the resources that we have available?
Definitely, yes. Some of the resources that are really helpful for you. One is, I'm plugging for Microsoft Virtual Academy. Not everyone has the luxury of a working Windows Server 2012 to play with, even though you can, you know, download maybe the demo and just check it out. If you want to have a free training on that, topic, you can go to the Virtual Academy, check it out. The other thing is, we already saw that there's a Jumpstart video that Ed and Rick did previously. You can check on that link. The last link you see in there is the link to the Exam 411 itself. And the reason I put it in there is some people think, oh, we've seen this before. If there's changes to any of the exam objectives, which mm-hmm. doesn't change all that much, but if there's any updates, you definitely see it reflected in that particular website. Something else that you can click into through the site, find out, is exam question formats. Not all of them are multiple choices, so get used to some of these different formats. Maybe there's a
click in the area.
Yeah, click in the area, hotspots.
Order things,
order
directions.
Things, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, so get used to that and anticipate that. So.
Great. Well, again, Cynthia, this has been a lot of fun.
All right, high
five. Hope it was fun for you guys also. And that's pretty much what we have for you.
Yeah.
We're glad you were here, and mm-hmm. we'll look forward to seeing you in another exam prep session.
Yes.